design. So if you don't know me, my name's Amanda. I'm majoring in broad area music education, and I recently finished my minor in accessibility studies. Central is the only, actually I don't know if they're the only one now, but the first university in the nation to have an accessibility studies program. They're usually disability justice programs, but this one's an accessibility program. So if you want to learn more about that, please never hesitate to talk to me about it. I'd love to talk about it. Okay. and so part of finishing my minor was completing a capstone project. So I decided to research the intersection of accessibility and music education by hopefully finding more accessible practices for us to use in our classrooms, and I specifically focused on universal design. Okay, so this is what I'm going to talk about today. The goals of my project, what universal design even is, applying universal design to our physical classroom space. Then we're going to talk about universal design for learning, applying UDL to our lesson planning, recommendations, and then I have a virtual handout at the end. So I have a bunch of QR codes with links to Google Drive documents that you can keep at the end of the day. Okay. I also want to preface this by saying I'm not an expert. I am excited to share with you what I have learned, though, and I'm really looking forward to learning even more. I do not consider this project anywhere near done, even though I finished the minor. I'm going to keep working on this my whole career. But I'm excited that you are interested in learning alongside me. Okay, so to start, did you know that of students participating in instrumental ensembles in our nation today, only 6.8% of them are students with disabilities? This does not reflect the demographics of our nation as a whole. Over double that is the percentage of students receiving special ed services, which is also a term I don't have time to talk about today. but what I want you to take from this is our music classrooms are not reflecting the student body the way that they should be. And I encourage you to ask yourself why. And 97% from this study of the educators they surveyed, they're teaching at least one student receiving those services, but only 58 have received college coursework in special ed. And also, I know 58 is more than half, but receiving coursework in special education does not equal being prepared to teach students that receive those services. Here at Central, we have one class called EDSE 302 Students with Exceptionalities. And without going on too far of a tangent there, I wrote an essay last fall when I took that class. I took that class the same time as my first accessibility studies class, and it was very frustrating. I wrote a paper that basically takes quotes from EDSE 302's syllabus and quotes from my accessibility textbook, and my accessibility textbook directly contradicts what the syllabus says. So if you're interested in that paper, I think that's one of the QR codes I included at the end. If not, I could email it to you. Just some light reading for the weekend. I basically propose that class has a complete remodel, a redesign, because the textbook is not written by a disabled person. They do not center the voice of the disabled experience at all, and they actually don't even say the word disability in the class, and disability is not a bad word. That's my little too long, don't read about that, but if you're interested in that paper, please let me know. But my point is, we do technically receive coursework in special education here at Central, but are we prepared? I don't think so. So the goals of my project is to educate educators on accessible practices and encourage us to all pursue this learning together. Also promote the value of music education to all students. Right now students are being excluded and I want music ed to be accessible to everyone. And then providing resources and strategies to implement these practices and hopefully produce classrooms that are designed for everyone. Okay, so what even is universal design? I'll refer to it as UD, universal design. It's a method of designing and creating environments that prioritizes accessibility for all its users. So if something is accessible, anyone can easily engage with it. The goal of UV is that anyone, regardless of disability, age, size, language, can use the environment or space to the greatest extent possible without the need for adaptation. We come across accessibility features every day. How many of us use the push buttons that open the doors to the music building all the time? You know? Yeah, I use it. Thanks, Logan. even if you don't use a wheelchair, that feature helps you. It supports you. But that is an example of an accommodation, not universal design. If it was universal design, those doors would be automatic. In the corner there, we have a wheelchair accessible table, so an SCR and MRI. That is an accommodation. If this room was universally designed, all of those tables would be that kind of table. Does that make sense? So universal design is not creating something and then adding band-aids to it later to make it accessible. From the beginning, accessibility is a priority, and it's designed so that anyone can engage with the space or product. So there are 7 principles of universal design. I just want to say that. I'm not going to lecture you on them in great detail. But if something, a product that you use or a space you interact with meets these 7 principles, it is considered universally designed. So now I'm going to go through and talk about how we could apply this to a physical classroom space. And another disclaimer, this is very idealistic. You know, we have school budgets to work with. And we don't get to build our classrooms from scratch. But it's kind of fun to think, what if we could? what would we change? So I'm going to go and just put a few ideas. This whole presentation is the spark notes of my F research essay. So if you're interested in more detail, also, yeah, I can give you that essay. But we're going to go through each of these briefly and how these could be implemented in a classroom. So for equitable use, I would say using a level hardwood flooring with optional rugs. A overarching theme of universal design is that you are giving your students options. Options of how they navigate and engage with what's in your classroom. Automatic doors, what I talked about earlier. And also, going into accessibility, I also consider financial barriers and issues for accessibility as well. And don't have time to get into that tonight, but that would also make your classroom more equitable. Is alleviating those restrictions. For flexibility in use, again, presenting several options for each classroom feature. So adjustable lighting, options of seating, and options of chair even. For simple and intuitive use, a brief ideas would be anything that you communicate with your students, such as classroom expectations, things that are constant every day, things should be stated verbally by you, but also written in clear text and posted within the classroom. There are also some fonts that are more accessible than others, and making sure that you write with very clear writing. Sometimes being aesthetically pleasing is not the greatest thing if it doesn't get your point across. And then any of your supplies that you use daily are kept in the same exact spot in your class all the time, and they're clearly labeled. Okay, yes, and anything that's labeled in the classroom, we'll show you the clear font. This font is Calibri, and it's an accessible font. It should also be use visual aids, so clip art. Use it. Or a photo of you, putting away a music stand properly. A series of photos. Something, the idea is that without you there, your students should be able to engage with the classroom in an appropriate way. Tolerance for error is a principle that mainly deals with safety. If there is something, if somebody were to engage with the space or the environment incorrectly, does the environment have a safety net for that? So for this one, I talked about in a choir setting, if you're using risers, they should be wide in width, so a very easy walkway, and they should have protective bars that are, they don't have to be up here, but something that someone could grab onto. And also, they should be approachable by a gradual ramp. Then we have low physical effort. Any instrument lockers that are in your room should be low to the ground, with large locks that also come with instructions on how to use them. Students should not have to exert much physical effort to access their instruments. And then the last one is size and space for approaching music. So I'm sure we can all picture our music classrooms cluttered with music stands and chairs and, you know, unpredictable walkways, and that's a big accessibility issue. So it's important not just for cleanliness, but for consistency and ease of use that your classroom is set up in an accessible way. Okay. I'm just laughing at you guys. Okay. So we have universal design, which is for physical space, and then we have universal design for learning, which is the pedagogical aspect of all this. So it's a teaching framework that applies universal design principles to lesson planning. The goal is to design classrooms that are inclusive and welcoming to all learners. And this one only has three main principles, and that is to provide multiple means of engagement, representation, and action and expression in each of your lessons. And I'm going to go through each of these and talk about them a bit more. So for multiple means of engagement, so keep in mind, this is just one lesson. We're just talking about one lesson, one day. You want your students to be able to engage with your lesson content in multiple ways. Little side note. There is no such thing as an average person. And we all learn differently. And I find with a lot of the education courses here, we are taught to teach one way, and if someone does not fall within that, they are an other student or someone that we need to accommodate. But we should be teaching in a way that connects with all types of learners. And this is, by using UDL, that's one way we can do that. So, for one lesson, playing your instruments, singing, clapping, and dancing, all to the same song. You practice as a large ensemble, if we're talking about middle school and high school, small group practice and individual practice. And also using music notation software, arranging software. You know, we have so much music technology now available to us that I think we should embrace. And nothing will pique the interest of a young kid more than a laptop. So utilizing those. These are a few music programs that I know of that are, if you want to go that route. You can use. Quaver Music is a whole curriculum, really popular with general music teachers at the elementary level. It's a whole world of things you're on person, and you can go through and do all these games. It's really cool. GarageBand, encouraging your students to like compose their own music in GarageBand. Earpeggio is a music theory app. That's awesome and good for ear training. Smart Music is a program you can actually use, there's like a teacher plan with it too, and you can, your students can practice into this program, and it tells them like how to improve, and it records them so you can listen to them individually. And MuseScore, which I'm sure you're familiar with, another notation software. Just different ways that can pique the interest of your students. For multiple means of representation, again, just one lesson plan. You can offer sheet music in multiple font sizes and colors, and there's also music braille, which we're going to talk about. I'm sure we've all received sheet music in the past that would have been easier to read if the font was a little bit larger, but we aren't given that option. Or if you have color blindness, using different color contrasts can help you as well. Using music visualizers to illustrate dynamic contrasts, that's a really fun way to take sound and put it in a and engage with it in a visual way, and we're going to talk about that in a second. I have an example to show you. And then projecting the score onto a screen during rehearsal. So instead of just shouting out navigational cues like, start at measure 60, you're also showing them what you're talking about and giving them context, which is another great way to represent what you're talking about. So this is music braille. I think this image is so interesting to look at because the bottom half of the screen is something I'm so familiar with, and the top is completely foreign to me, but they're the same thing. There's a whole braille code for music. It's about 500 pages long. I can send it to you if you want. And here's just a glimpse into some of the rules, how the code works. But I had never heard of this before. I wish I had. There's a whole population of musicians that use this that I don't know about. At the end there, I have a citation It's the music for Elm Code. If you type that into Google, I'm sure you'll find it. Okay, and then here's an example of a music visualizer. It shows the Rite of Spring. This is just one. Hello? Can I not make it? Okay, well.
Students were constantly displaying on the quality of our writing.
Okay.
Thank you. recognize that this instrument is a saxophone. And many of you recognize that tune as Take Five by Paul Desmond. But what probably you didn't notice is the fact that I play my saxophone in a very unusual way. I play my saxophone with only one hand. Saxophones, and for that matter, all commercially available musical instruments, are designed to be played with two able-bodied classical hands. But the thing of it is, I don't have two good hands. 17 years ago, I had a stroke that paralyzed the left side of my body. I had no movement in my leg, the left side of my abdomen, my left arm was paralyzed, my left hand had no movement, the left side of my neck was paralyzed, the left side of my face was paralyzed, even the left side of my tongue was paralyzed. Since at the time of my stroke, I was already a professional musician and assistant professor of music at the University of Nebraska at Kearney, my health created some real problems for me. So in an effort for me to return to work, teaching and performing on the saxophone, I worked together with Jeff Stelling of Stelling Brass and Winds to develop this instrument that I just played for you with one hand. I'm now working to make more instruments like mine available to persons with disabilities. To a person with a disability, an instrument like this represents an opportunity for undifferentiated participation in music. When I say undifferentiated participation in music, what I mean is that with a well-designed musical instrument, a person with a disability can make music with the same facility, with the same fluency, indeed with as much artistic integrity as an able-bodied person playing a conventional musical instrument. Let's consider the implications of an instrument just like this just a bit further. When I played my saxophone for you a moment ago, you saw me as a saxophone player. Nothing more, nothing less. That is the potential of an adaptive musical instrument. Because of this instrument, my disability disappeared. This instrument in my hands enabled my transformation from what had been a person with a disability to lose the with a disability and return to being simply a person once again. That's a very powerful change. That is the power of an adaptive musical instrument, and that's what undifferentiated participation in music is all about. In the years since my stroke, thank you.
Jimi Hendrix. How about the next one?
My entire references page for my also just like YouTube links and articles to check out if you're interested. Yeah, we have a couple seconds more for that. I think that's my last slide. So, yeah, are there any questions, thoughts, anything about anything else? Yes.
So whenever I talk about accessibility in the classroom, music-wise and stuff, people always say that when you try to make something accessible, it's not going to be accessible for another student, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm kind of, I don't believe that. I think that you can make a classroom accessible and have it accessible for all your students too. But what would you say to someone that says that, that if you make one thing accessible, what about the other students that don't need that?
Yeah, I think that ties back to what I talked about earlier about the accommodations versus universal design.
Mm-hmm.
I'd love to know what specifically they're talking about.
I know, yeah.
I don't think that increasing access for one person means that you're creating barriers for others. But there might be scenarios I don't know about. But I think that's why, especially universal design, is something I'm particularly interested in. And instead of just accommodation, because you know, you start layering up accommodations, like why do we need accommodations?
Yeah.
You know, we need to start from the beginning. Like something is fundamentally wrong here.
Yeah.
You know, and so that's probably what I would say to that. Starting from scratch is what I would do.
What are some ways, if you are, you know, going to a new school and starting from scratch, that maybe, like, implementing, I guess, like, what kind of universal design would you start with?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, work with what you have and work with their own speed. The biggest thing here is that this is all based on research. I obviously don't have my own classroom yet, but what I would do is evaluate what I can control, and I can control what's inside my classroom and the way I organize it. I probably can't control what the lockers look like, but I can control how I label the things around my classroom, how I speak to my students, how I communicate with them. We talked about briefly the financial aspect. I think we already know that advocacy is a huge part of our job, but I think adding this to that, the video I showed of the middle school playing Star Spangled Banner, it looked like they were at City Hall or something. You know, it was clearly advocating for their program in that way. And I think those kinds of experiences too, if you don't have much available to you at your school, talking to the people that can give you what you need about this, and asserting that it is important to you and your classroom and your students. Start with what you do have. Show that you can do that well, and advocate to get yourself more. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
I haven't been able to put this fully in practice, so it's based fully on research that I've read from other people, but and I've been able to use it a little bit in my one-on-one lessons, but I don't have a classroom, so. Anything else?
Have you found an example of, like, an actual classroom set up with universal design?
I have not found a classroom that has fully implemented UDs, no. There's somebody on the East Coast named Jesse Rathweber, who I really want to get in contact with, who wrote a book about using universal design for learning in the music setting. And I think a big paper about that, too, that I wasn't able to access on, like, one of those things. But anyway. and then he's the only person I know of that has used universal design, but that's universal design for learning. So, not to say that some teachers haven't, you know, tried, but I couldn't find any.
Right.
Oh, we should really try this. What's the name of that? Jesse Rathgeber. I'm hoping to reach out to him and have him speak to us here sometime this year. Thank goodness for Zoom, because he's across the country. Any other thoughts?
Thank you for sharing, Amanda.
Thank you for taking time. Please never hesitate to come talk to me about this stuff. I love talking about it, and I'm constantly adding to it and learning more, and I'd love to learn out about it. So, thank you for taking time out of your day to listen, and take this to your students. So, that's the goal. Thank you.